today with Fred Hermes, who has a Wurlitzer organ and a movie palace that he built a house around.
First idea was I thought about picking up a Wurlitzer when I was a little kid from the Rialto Theater down in Racine. And I got to tell people, my mother used to take me down to the theater and I'd kick her all over the place. And I decided when the organ would play, and I decided then someday I was going to buy that organ. And then about 3 weeks later, I was born. And whether that's a true story or not, or something I made up, I don't really know for sure.
Okay, you're just going to stick to that one, huh?
Yeah, as good as any. Pump organ, that was my first organ. You know, that old pump organ, reed organ, from about 1880. From some old lady who lived down the hill from us on LaSalle Street. She had it sitting on her porch. I used to walk by that on the way to school all the time. And it intrigued me, so I asked her if she wanted to sell it, and she says, yeah. I said, how much you want? She says, $2. Went home, found $2. Got about four or five kids my age, you know, about 10 years old. Coaster wagon, put on that, pulled it up the hill, and put it in front of the fireplace. My mother came home was waiting for her. Well, she liked to sing, so I actually started accompanying her. She liked to sing Beautiful Dreamer and other songs, and so I would play for her, and we got a gooder, better relationship going then.
So when did you start playing organ?
I would say I started playing on it when I was 8 years old, when I bought that pump organ.
Okay.
Of course, I'd been taking piano lessons for, you know, a couple of years beforehand. Okay. But I liked the sound of the organ. Wurlitzer built over 2,500 organs in the teens and into the 20s. Most of them for theaters and a lot for churches. The first Wurlitzer I bought was a two-manual Wurlitzer, two keyboards with seven sets of pipes. Well, it wasn't big enough, and half of it was ruined by water. That was from the Rialto Theater in town here. That's where it came from, because it was in two chambers, one on each side of the stage. And so I had to find something to replace that, so then I went to Milwaukee and found one in the Riviera Theater. That was a complete organ of five ranks, but had everything I needed and was in mint condition. So I bought that. I offered him $200 for it. He says, no, we got to get more than that. I says, what? He says, well, somebody else offered me $200 for it. And I turned him down. I said, well, how much did you want for it? $225.
Okay.
I said, he said, $25. My friends and I took it apart, pulled it down, because there are a lot of parts in these organs.
Mm-hmm.
It isn't like an organ, an electronic organ.
Right.
You pick it up and carry it away. And I had that, then I wanted something bigger. And so, like everybody wants, all guys want something bigger, you know.
Sure.
And so I happened to be looking in the organ magazine, and there was a Wurlitzer organ for sale in the First Baptist Church, Madison, Wisconsin. So my wife and I went up to look at that, see what it was. Who knows what it was in the church.
Mm-hmm.
So I got up there and looked at it, and just what I wanted. It was a four-manual Wurlitzer, a four-keyboard. I'd sold the other organ to Bill Leggett out at Browns Lake for his ballroom there.
Okay.
And then I went up there and they asked me, I looked at the organ and I asked them what they wanted for it. They said, well, we got to have, I think, $3,000, I think they said. I said, well, I'll give you
$300.
And he said, well, he kind of snickered. He said, well, if we're interested, we'll call you.
Mm-hmm.
No sooner I got home and the phone rang, he said, come and get it. And I think it was 1949, something like that. Took it apart, called it, installed it in the basement of our office building. And of course, even had a radio program there. I'd play the organ, and being a member of the real estate board, they'd read our listings.
Mm-hmm.
And I got my listings read for nothing because I was playing the program for them. Thank you. And then still wanted something bigger. So I looked through, I got a copy of Wurlitzer's installation list of their 2,500 organs or something like that.
Mm-hmm.
So I went through that, and there are a lot of four manual organs that were pretty big, one mm-hmm. radius in the City Music Hall was four. But all the thousands of organs, they only built three that have five keyboards. And of the three they had, this was the biggest. That means it has the most pipes in it.
Okay.
And so I decided I wanted that organ. So I called a friend of mine out in Detroit, because that's where it was located, in the Michigan Theater in Detroit. And he said the organ wasn't for sale, but it was in the Michigan Theater. It was still there. So I decided, well, I'm going to go over and talk to the guy. He said, sure, you can look at it. I really don't want to sell it.
Mm-hmm.
I said, yeah, but you know, this organ was run down the bottom of the pit. They took the lift apart that the organ was sitting on and threw it away and disconnected the blower. And they cut a hole in the face of the stage wall,
mm-hmm.
concrete wall, shoved the console through the wall, and cemented the wall up behind. So I ain't going anywhere.
So the organ was basically sort of in a vault that you couldn't get into?
It was there in a room. They shoved it through it and it cemented the wall. No way to get it out that way. So he says, well, you're never going to use it. Well, it's not in the way. So I said, well, Frank Dillon, that was his name. By then I knew him enough to call him by his first name. Let me tell you something. I'm in a real estate business and an insurance business. And I checked with the city of Detroit before I came in over here to see how much personal property taxes you were paying on that organ.
Mm-hmm.
And he was paying, they were paying maybe $1,000 a year. And
was this 1955?
Yeah, well, yeah. But I said, you've been paying that for 20 years. I said, you threw 20 grand down the rat hole the last 20 years. You keep it here another 20 years.
Mm-hmm.
It's going to get another, you're going to want to throw $40,000 after something. That made him change his mind. I says to Frank, I says, what do you want for the organ? He says, well, I want $3,000 for it. I says, well, Frank, I says, no, he wanted $5,000.
Okay.
I said, I'll tell you what, I'll give you $1,000. No, he wanted more than that. We negotiated a price of $3,000. And we settled for $3,000, and that's what I sold the other organ for anyway, so it came out even anyway. So then I got, then I paid him the money, and he said, he called me up, Fred, we got another problem. I said, what's that? And he says, well, everything that we, in the theater that we own, is leased to the United Detroit Theaters. And that was a big going theater at the time.
Okay.
And he said, we don't want to be bothered. The manager said, we don't want to be bothered with all the dirt and the noise and the dust and hauling that thing out and stuff like that. So he says, he can buy the organ, but he can't take it out till our lease runs out in 20 years.
That's a problem.
So I said, Frank, he called me on the phone and told me that. I said, Frank, like I told you, I was in the real estate. I want to come over and see the lease.
Mm-hmm.
He hauled it out, took the dust off it. Nobody looked at it for 30 years or more. So I opened up the last page or two. He says, Fred, don't you want to start at the beginning? I said, no. I says, leases are like insurance policies. The big print in the front gives it to you, and the little print in the back takes it all away.
Okay.
So I says, okay, here's your answer. It's in the last page. And final condition of this lease is that everything leased to United Detroit Theaters must be maintained in first-class operating condition. If it's found not to be so, there's $1,000 a month fine until it's put back in shape. And I said, Frank, I said, I'm just guessing it cost $50,000 to put that organ back in shape. Once you knock that wall down and get it out and find another lift to put it on and hook up the blower, and he said, you're going to have $60,000-$70,000 in that. So he calls the guy and tells the dealer, I could hear it swear across the room and I won't use his language. Get the blanky blank thing out of here.
Mm-hmm.
So that took care of that. And we made the deal. Then we had a problem with this. Detroit's a union town, you know. So we had a problem with the stagehand union. They wanted something. I said, what did you guys want to help me take the organ? I said, a couple of bottles of whiskey will help you. So
okay, there you go.
I got hold of Merchant's Delivery. I said, on Saturday, I want your two biggest moving van semi-trailers behind the theater early in the morning on Saturday. Because you're going to have to load it on Saturday. We'll have it all apart for you to carry out And you have to move it on Sunday because your truck could well be overloaded, but then the weigh stations are closed on Sunday.
Okay.
So we worked every day about, I would say, 10, 11 hours a day taking that thing apart,
mm-hmm.
getting ready for them when they got there. When we took this organ out, it was the middle of February, and a sleet storm is coming. And I had asked the city to post a sign, no parking behind the theater, Michigan Theater. We got there about 6 o'clock in the morning, and the trucks were there, and there were signs along the sidewalk. No parking today, and people were lining up. The sign said, the only signs they could find that said, no parking parade today.
So they thought there was going to be a parade?
In the middle of February. Charlie Conrad, he was one of the three that helped me. He said, and a sleet storm was coming. He said, I thought I did everything when I was shooting. He was a pilot.
Mm-hmm.
He said, I shot down MiGs all over North Korea. It was my jet plane. I said, and I thought I did everything, but I never thought I'd be carrying a pipe organ on a fire escape in the middle of a sleet storm. They carried out the heavy stuff and reloaded, packed the pipes and boxes they brought along that I had them bring along for me for packing the little stuff in, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And they hauled it back to the basement on an office building down on 6th Street, and which had a couple thousand square feet in the basement, and had it down there and worked it over and restored it and re-leathered it and all that kind of stuff and brought it out here. By then the basement had been built with no house on top, just the framework.
Okay.
And it took another couple of years to put it together. And that's what happened then.
So, you brought it here. And it took two semi-trucks to pack all the stuff in, or three?
Oh, yeah. Oh, two semis. Plus, then we went back for another truckload of stuff.
Okay. But how big is this organ?
We had this organ that was hauled on the basement of our office. I told you that.
Right. You stored it for a couple of years while you were building the house to put it into, right?
Well, we were building the house, and then we restored the organ at the same time.
Okay. And how long did it take you to, once you got the organ here, in this house, how long did it take you to get it to where it was playable?
Well, maybe 6 months. But that, don't forget, it's a big organ. We had part of it playable so you could use it. And that was only a small part of the organ.
Okay.
So we had something we could play with anyway. There are all over 3,000 pipes in this organ. And the longest pipe is about 20 feet long, and it weighs about 300-400 pounds.
So the organ console itself weighs how much?
I would say close to a ton.
Somewhere, I think you told me how much the pipes weighed.
Well, the whole thing all together weighed, I'm just guessing, maybe 20 tons all together. This organ, when it was new, cost $65,000 in 1926. If you were to reproduce this organ today, you're looking at about $3 million. But that's if you ask an organ company to build it for you. That's because the average church organ today costs over almost $1 million.
I know you said it has five manuals on it.
Yeah.
And you were saying that it's the biggest organ that Wurlitzer made. Is it literally this model?
This model is the biggest organ they built with five keyboards.
And what does that mean? What is a rank?
A set of pipes like here. I'll show you a brass trumpet now.
Okay.
A trumpet rank. Set of pipes. A pipe, there's 61 pipes.
Okay.
Starting at the bottom key all the way to the top. You got a brass trumpet pipe. But the longest one is 9 feet long, the shortest one is about 6 inches.
Okay.
You gotta have that for every set of pipes in the organ. The flutes, the strings, everything else, because you have to have one for every key. And the flutes, you have to have over more than that, 97, because they go up to the piccolo and the fife octave. And then you have to have all of the B pipes up there. And also, some of the big pipes, like the tuba, that goes down into the pedal, and that's where you have that big pipe, because that's the base of the organ. So
okay.
It's really extended an octave below.
Okay, and how many notes are on the pedal
30,
board on
32.
This?
32.
Okay.
That's standard.
So how long did it take you to actually get all the pipes and everything working on the organ?
A couple of years.
Now, you did it yourself?
No, I had a lot of friends help.
Okay, that's kind of what I figured. It seems like a pretty big...
I used to have two, three guys, high school kids, help me.
Yeah.
See, we're sitting on a ravine here.
Mm-hmm.
And those are the powerful pipes in that chamber. We had the back door open, you know, for no air conditioning here, just to keep it cool. Play those pipes, they were walking up the beach, and they heard some of the organ music. They followed right up the creek to where it was, and then they came in here, and then they hung around for 2 years putting it together for me.
Well, that's pretty nice.
And both of them are... Both these guys are... No, one of them is dead now. The other one's down in Texas, living still there. And so they, and then I had other people come and help me all the time because all the wind lines that connect the different divisions of the organ, sets of pipes, they're all metal tubing. And they're all soldered.
Oh, okay.
Just stuck together. They're soldered. That was that heavy solder. That was all done by hand, and we all did that ourselves.
Brought it here in 59 and got it all fully working by, what, about 65?
Yeah, I would say that's close. No, yeah. Earlier than that. Got it all working about 1960, 61. Okay.
Start building out the theater, because we're sitting in seats that came out of some famous theater, right?
Yeah. Actually, all we had here in the first place was four bare walls, four concrete walls. There wasn't any lobby back there. There were four walls.
Okay.
And we had a few chairs back there. We had a couple of chairs with boards on them, planks on them, so people could sit on them.
Mm-hmm.
That was in the era, let me see, I'm guessing now. Starting around 1969, I think, 67, they started tearing down all these beautiful movie palaces because people weren't coming downtown anymore. They went out to malls and those dumpy little theaters. And it cost a lot of fortune to maintain a 5,000 seat movie, so they would just tear them down. And some of them were saved from performing arts centers, thank goodness for that.
Mm-hmm.
And then when they started tearing them down, then I would get hold of the billing records, and they'd say, if you want to come and get some stuff for your, just come and get it, because there's less stuff for us to haul to the dump.
Sure.
So that's where I got a lot of the stuff. Oh, the Venetian Theater at that.
Okay.
The whole inside of the place looks like the Venetian.
Yeah, you were saying earlier that really the Venetian is the was the premier movie palace in Racine, right?
Yes, it was. It was a movie palace. The seats came from the balcony of the Uptown Theater.
Give me a little quiz earlier about why you want the seats from the balcony versus the floor.
Well, because the balcony seats, the floor seats, You don't want those because the floor slope. Okay. If you take them out and put them on a flat floor, then the seats are going to lean way back because the back legs were shorter to make up for the sloping floor.
Mm-hmm.
So you got to know that. And usually the theater seats in the balcony were in better shape because the balcony hardly ever got used. And a lot of the theaters closed the balcony. They wouldn't let anybody up there.
Mm-hmm.
You notice there's no padding in the back of these seats?
Mm-hmm.
I took all the padding out. And the reason for that is, if you got organ music or live music, you want the room to be as live as possible. Reverberation.
Okay.
You
know
what that is. The decor and the walls and the columns and the statuary, those big griffins up there, all that stuff came from the Venetian theater at the time.
Okay.
The whole inside of the place looks like the Venetian.
How many seats do you have in the theater?
There's 101 on the main floor and about 35 in the balcony.
Okay.
Back in the early days when I had had seats out here, we had organists coming up every weekend from Chicago. Pearl White was one of them. Came actually John Muriel, all these big name organists.
Because mm-hmm.
there were no theater organs that were working down in that area, or anywhere else for that matter.
Okay.
Because the theater organ enthusiasts hadn't really gotten involved to restore these instruments. Mm-hmm. Those that were left.
Okay.
But a lot of them were thrown out, you know.
Yeah, that's what I've heard and what you told me, is that they just cut them up and threw them in a dumpster to get rid of them.
Yeah, and incidentally, during the war, a lot of them took the metal pipes out of the organ and just melted them down.
No.
Because everybody's looking for scrap metal.
Sure.
Annually, we usually do the Phantom of the Opera for our organ club.
Okay. And then you have a guest organist come in and...
Yeah,
and
Dennis Scott, he plays that whole film. That's the original silent film version from 1925.
Thank you.
heard you playing earlier, and it didn't sound like all I heard were organ sounds. So it sounds like the organ itself has the ability to do more than just flutes and tubas.
Oh, yeah. The theater organ has percussion. It has drums. It has tambourines, castanets, tom-toms. It's got a couple of xylophones. It's got a marimba, and it's got tuned orchestra bells. You heard them ringing out.
I can.
Sounds like a bunch of angels sing along. Wow. You know, it sounds like a lot of strings.
Yeah.
Stop in the organ. Thank you. tuned orchestra bells. You heard them ringing out there.
Okay, that was what
that
I was hearing.
On that panel over there.
Sure.
So that's all that stuff they put in the theater, because you never play music that might fit the film that was written later than the film was. A theater organ was designed to replace the orchestra.
Mm-hmm. So it had to have everything, including the drums and the bells.
Yeah,
and
that created a problem. Now, in some theaters, the orchestras were so mad, some of them cut the organ cables. not too many, I only know one or two cases, but that put the orchestra out of business.